This audio is brought to you by Muslim Central. Please consider donating to help cover our running costs and future projects by visiting www.muslimcentral.com/donate. Ansar International.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala abdihi wa rasulihi nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in amma ba'd ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. I welcome our dear brothers and sisters in al-Islam. I welcome the listeners of Radio Al-Ansar. Ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. Your brother in Islam, Bilal Ismail of the Al-Kawthar Institute and Imam Development Project with you. Another beautiful Wednesday evening. And another one of our majalis, majalis of knowledge, majalis of ilm, majalis of dhikr, majalis of the mention of the name of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And say sallallahu alayhi wasallam when you hear his name. Brothers and sisters, we are currently going through the series, the 40 Ahadith of Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah. May Allah be pleased with that scholar, that alim, that zahid, that imam rahimahullah. Walhamdulillah, masha'Allah, tabarakallah. We have concluded with plus minus 18 Ahadith of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam from this 40 Ahadith collection. And last Wednesday, we began with hadith number 19. This hadith, subhanallah, as some of the ulama stated with regards to it, that it left them perplexed. It left them a bit dazed, subhanallah. Why? Because it was super amazing. This hadith here, super amazing. And some of them said, woe to the one who does not benefit from this hadith. Woe to the one who is ignorant of this hadith. Some ulama, Ibn al-Jawzi, he said, I pity the one who is ignorant of this hadith and does not have or has little understanding of it. Hadith number 19 from the 40 Ahadith collection. Walhamdulillah. Brothers and sisters, in our previous majlis, we went through half of our explanation. We have half left, insha'Allah. And that's what we will conclude with tonight, insha'Allah. We will wrap up all matters related to hadith number 19, insha'Allah. But before that, bi'ithnillahi ta'ala, a little bit of recapping, a little bit of revision, insha'Allah. Why? وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ ذِكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ And remind, for verily the reminder is beneficial to the believers, subhanAllah. We all forget, نَسِيَ Adam وَنَسِيَ ذُرِّيَّتَهُ Adam, he had forgotten. Adam, our father, alayhi salam, he had forgotten. And thus his progeny, those who came from him, they also forget. Allahu musta'an. Ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah. Hadith number 19. An Abil Abbas, Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. Upon the authority of Abu Abbas, Abdullah ibn Abbas. So who are we talking about? Who is the narrator? Who passed on this hadith? None other than Abdullah ibn Abbas. His kunya was Abul Abbas. His kunya, his agnomen was Abul Abbas. And his father's name was Abbas, subhanAllah. Maybe that's why he named his kid Abbas, because his father's name was Abbas, radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. May Allah have mercy upon both of them, Abdullah ibn Abbas and his father, Al-Abbas, uncle of the Rasul Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What does he say? He says, Kuntu khalfa an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I was behind the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Other narrations, Kuntu radifa an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I was seated on the same animal behind the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So both of them on the same animal, yoman, on a day. Faqala li ya ghulam. And then the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to him, O young man, ya ghulam, inni u'allimuka kalimat, I will teach you, I will teach you some words. Some words of what? Words of advice. Brothers and sisters, this hadith here, we had stated, reported by Imam At-Tirmidhi, we said that there are various chains and various wordings of this hadith which come from Abdullah ibn Abbas. We said that the first narration is sahih. Numerous various different chains it has, and it has been graded sahih by Sheikh Ahmed Shakir, by Sheikh Al-Albani, by Sheikh Shu'ib Arnaout and others, reported in the Musnad of Imam Ahmed and in the Sunan of Imam At-Tirmidhi. As for the second narration, it's in the Musnad of Abd ibn Humaid, and it has some weakness in it. Then we had moved on to the biography of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. What can one remember with regards to his biography? We said that the Abbasid dynasty, for example, they attribute themselves to Abdullah ibn Abbas and his father. We said his kunya was Al-Bahar. Bahar is the ocean. Why is he called ocean? Because he was an ocean of knowledge, subhanallah. He's also called Habrul Ummah. And he was born at the time when the Muslims were being boycotted by the Quraysh. He was born in the Shi'b of Abu Talib, and it was around 3 years before the Hijrah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he narrates plus minus 1,660 ahadith from the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He is one of those seven famous narrators of ahadith, those who narrate the most number of ahadith. One day, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam made dua for him. What dua? Subhanallah. Youngster, young boy. And our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam is making dua for him. What dua was it? Allahumma faqihu fid deen. O Allah, grant him the understanding of the religion. Wa'allimhu ta'wil. And grant him the understanding of the noble Qur'an. The ability to make tafsir of the noble Qur'an. Allahumma faqihhu fid deen. Wa'allimhu ta'wil. Who's making the dua? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. For who? For Abdullah ibn Abbas, his cousin. And this dua was accepted, subhanallah. Because as we said, he was one of the foremost scholars of this ummah. Brothers and sisters, he is also one of the four Abadila, Jayid, the four Abadila, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Az-Zubair, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn Al-As, and our Abdullah ibn Abbas. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala would enter him into the discussions of the major Sahaba. We discussed the reasons for that. We said that he was also the Amir over Basra during the time in the Caliphate of Ali radiallahu ta'ala. And he passed away in the city of Ta'if. What was his age at the time? Plus minus 68 to about 71, difference of opinion amongst the ulama. And this was in the year 68 AH. When somebody spoke to Umar radiallahu ta'ala and they were discussing Abdullah ibn Abbas, Umar said about him, لَهُ لِسَانٌ سَأُولُ وَقَلْبٌ أَقُولُ. This Abdullah ibn Abbas, he has a heart which is attentive and a tongue which is wet by asking questions, subhanallah. Very, very curious. Very, very curious. Always asking about this and about that. And they asked him, some people had asked Abdullah ibn Abbas, you know, how did you become this great scholar and know so much, etc.? He said that I had a tongue which was moist with asking questions, and I had a heart which was attentive, subhanallah. And he would go during the time when many people were asleep. He would sit outside the homes of certain sahaba until they would leave the home. Then he would ask them questions. They would say to him, oh, the cousin of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there's no need for you to do this. No need for you to wait outside our homes. You should tell us, we would come to you, you not come to us. He said, no, this is how we were taught to learn from our ulama when it comes to seeking knowledge, etc. That we will go seeking it and we won't wait for it to come to us, subhanallah, radiyallahu anhu. Brothers and sisters, we had discussed his biography in great detail in our previous majlis, walhamdulillah, and that was just a little bit to recap, insha'Allah. As for the importance of this hadith, we learnt that Ibn al-Jawzi said that I pondered over this hadith and it amazed me to the point that I became light-headed. Subhanallah, Ibn al-Jawzi, that mountain of knowledge. He said, what a pity for the one ignorant of this hadith. And he said that, what a pity for the one ignorant of this hadith and the one who understands very, very little of its meaning. Allah musta'an. Ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah. Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali rahimahullah, he has a book dedicated to this hadith, Nurul Iqtibas fi Mishka Wasiyat Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Ibn Abbas. An entire book explaining just this one hadith. Subhanallah. Why? Because here the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching this young boy, teaching him about what? Teaching him about the most important matters, teaching him about the matter of Tawheed, subhanallah, teaching him about the matter of predestination, preordainment, the matter of taqdeer, that which gives you courage, that which does not let you slacken down, that gives you hope, subhanallah. And thus, ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah, this hadith here gives me, gives you, should give all of us strength for us in this world and for the hereafter. Brothers and sisters, as for the explanation, we said that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam riding the animal Abdullah ibn Abbas behind him. And Abdullah ibn Abbas was a very young boy when the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. But this hadith here, he states clearly, I heard this from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Numerous, in fact, most of the ahadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas, he narrates from other sahaba because he was very young. He was maybe about 12, 13 years old when the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. So he learnt from the other companions. So he would narrate that, I heard from so and so sahabi, etc. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said such and such. Or he would just narrate directly, but it's understood that he learnt this, he picked this up from other companions, walhamdulillah. But this hadith, brothers and sisters, he is clear, he is explicit. I was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I heard him saying, he called me, he addressed me, O young man. Subhanallah. So here, the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam uses that term of maybe like endearment, O young man, ya ghulam, getting the attention of Abdullah ibn Abbas. And that's exactly what happened. Abdullah ibn Abbas did not forget this hadith. In fact, he even adds the circumstances. We were on the animal and we were moving, etc. And then he told me this and he told me that. Subhanallah. And this point here is mentioned when it comes to teaching techniques. Ya ghulam, O young man, I will teach you some words. And the word kalimat, this is jam' qillah. The word kalimat, jam' qillah. And it gives an impression that it will be a few words. A few words. Although it's plural, but it's a few words. Few words of advice. You'll be able to memorize them. Easy for you to memorize. Ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah. The word ghulam. Ghulam is this youngster, and generally it's used from the age of eating solid foods up to around 9-10 years. So any kid around that age, we would call him ghulam. From the point that they start eating solids up to around 9-10 years, then the term used is ghulam. And there's the other narration, ghulayyim. Ghulayyim is like a small version of a ghulam. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaching Abdullah ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Abbas may be 13 years old. Soon he might be baligh. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching him in this hadith about patience, hardship, about victory, about relief that comes after hardship. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we know, he took out time to teach the youth. Abdullah ibn Abbas, Ibn Mas'ud, Nu'man ibn Bashir and others. And later on in their lives, these teachings became like second nature to them, subhanallah. And thus we learn from this, that when it comes to our youngsters, make sure that we inculcate within them the essentials of the deen from a young age. Sad when a brother, mashallah, has got a massive beard and he's 39 years old and he does not know how to make wudu, Allahu musta'an. When somebody comes and asks that when I perform my ghusl, you know what if, for example, it's in winter and I don't wash my hair, is that fine? Allahu musta'an, ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah. When somebody doesn't know what to do, does not know how to recite Suratul Fatiha, when the imams, when the man's a trustee at the masjid, he is the chairman of the board, but when the imam's not there, he is ashamed to go forward. Why? To be the imam. Why? Because he does not know Suratul Fatiha properly. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Allahu musta'an, Allahu musta'an. Ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, inni أُعَلِّمُكَ كلمات. Indeed, I will teach you some words of advice. Some narrations mention يَنْفَعُكَ اللَّهُ بِهِنْ. Allah will help you with these words. Allah will benefit you via these words. And did they work? 100%. Because Abdullah ibn Abbas remembered those words, narrated it on to others, and he even mentions the circumstances. What were the words? اِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ يَحْفَظْكَ اِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ يَحْفَظْكَ. That's be mindful, look after Allah, be mindful of the limits, the orders of Allah, the deen of Allah, and Allah will look after you. Similar to how Allah mentions, Allah mentions in the Noble Quran, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu in tansurullaha yansurukum. If you help Allah, Allah will help you. If you help Allah what Allah needs your help. Have the deen of Allah, then Allah will assist you. Allah will help you. We find in the Noble Quran, فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرُكُمْ. Remember me and I will remember you. Subhanallah. When we take the name of Allah, when we remember Allah, brothers and sisters, when you say Subhanallah, when you do not do something because you know Allah's watching, when you do something because you know Allah's watching and you are supposed to do it and you do it, when you want to take something you are not supposed to take because you know Allah's watching, when you held yourself back because Allah knows, Subhanallah. When you did that, that was your dhikr of Allah. That was your remembrance of Allah. And that's what happens in return. فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرُكُمْ. Remember me and I will remember you. Who will remember us? Who will make mention of us? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the gatherings of the angels. Allahu musta'an, Subhanallah, Subhanallah. Then we find Allah also stating in the Noble Quran, إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرُكُمْ. If you assist the deen of Allah, then Allah will assist you. وَأَوْفُ بِعَهْدِي أُوفِ بِعَهْدِكُمْ. And fulfill your covenant with me, with Allah, and then Allah will also do the same to you. Allah will protect you. Allah will protect your wealth, your family, your deen. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amat Allah, every one of us, we are needy. We are fuqara before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, look after the limits of Allah. Look after the deen of Allah. Be mindful of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look after you. In terms of your tongue. In terms of your stomach. Your salah. Your eyes. Your wealth. Your health. Your family. Your responsibilities. Whatever it might be. You be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus Allah will be mindful of you. When it comes to belief, when it comes to the hudud, the limits of Allah, when it comes to the rights of others, the huquq of others. And that's why many of the ulama, they summarize those three matters. They mention the matter of the aqa'id, the beliefs. Then they mention the matter of the hudud, the limits of Allah, where Allah's put the limits. And then the huquq of others, the rights of others. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amat Allah. Once Sa'id ibn Musayyib, famous scholar of the Tabi'een, he was prolonging his salah. And, he says that I prolonged my salah for the sake of my son. For the sake of your son? Yeah, in the hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will preserve my son, look after my son. Allah will make hifz of my son, safeguard my son, due to my prolonging of my salah. What does your salah got to do with the with the protection of your son? The verse in the Noble Quran, Surah Kahf, verse number 82. وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا. And those individuals, their parents, the father, he was a righteous man. And thus the kids, the progeny were protected because the parent was righteous. And so if you are righteous, then that is part and parcel of the means of protection for your kids. Angels around us protecting us, brothers and sisters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we want Allah to look after our affairs. Yes or no? I want Allah to look after my affairs. And thus, I should look after the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. احفظ الله تجده تجاهك. That be mindful of Allah and you will find Allah before you. You will find Allah with you. This is ma'iyya khassa. This is a special type of closeness Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has with these individuals. This here, you know, is that like how with regards to Musa alayhi salam and Harun, Allah mentions, إِنَّنِي مَعَكُمَا أَسْمَعُ وَأَرَى. I am with both of you, with Musa and Harun. I hear and I see. When it was the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with Abu Bakr in the cave, لا تحزن إن الله معنا. Do not be saddened, do not grieve. Verily Allah is with us. Do not grieve, Allah is with us. The special type of Allah, Allah's protection, Allah's closeness, Allah's help and support, Allah's guiding them. إن الله مع الذين تقوا والذين هم محسنون. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with those who have taqwa, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with those who are the muhsinun. Subhanallah. Ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Noble Quran, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. And Allah is with you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ, knows whatever you do. Allah sees whatever you do. Surah Hadith, verse number 4. This sentence, it emphasizes the previous sentence. It tells us that if we are mindful of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be with us in a special type of closeness. Then the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam states, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ. And if you ask, when you ask, you need to ask because you are faqir. So you will ask, you will seek help. When you ask, ask from Allah alone. Allah wants us, brothers and sisters, to ask from His bounties. That Allah states, وَاسْأَلُ اللَّهَ مِنْ فَضْلِ. Surah Nisa, verse number 32. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from His bounties. Ask for small, ask for big, ask for everything and anything. We find the hadith reported by Imam At-Tirmidhi. يَسْأَلُ أَحَدُكُمْ رَبَّهُ حَاجَتَهُ. Any one of you, you should ask Allah for whatever you need. حَتَّى يَسْأَلْ. Even you ask, شِسْعَنَ عَلِهِ. Even if it be like the shoelace, إِذَنْ قَطَعْ. If it broke, subhanAllah. Any small, tiny thing, you should ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's only Allah. It's only Allah, Allah. Allah alone is the one who truly can grant our needs. So thus, turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and depend and rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions that verse of the Noble Quran, Surah Ghafir, verse number 60. وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Noble Quran, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ, your Rabb said, ادْعُونِي, make dua to me, أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ, make dua to me, and I will answer your dua. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amat Allah. When one turns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, depends upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, relies on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, this is part and parcel of the tawheed that the Muslim believes in. Even if it be in matters where others can help you. Example, you know, help me with this box, pick this up for me, bring me this, bring me that, etc. That is fine, no problem. These people can assist you. وَتَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Brother, please, can you help me with the chair? Brother, can you please bring me this? Wife, please bring this or take this, etc. Whatever it might be. All of this is fine. But subhanAllah, a higher level would be not to even ask for that. We find the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith reported in Sahih Muslim, he took a pledge, he took an oath from Abu Bakr, from Thuban, from Abu Dharr and others, that they will not ask anything from anyone to such a level, if they were on the animals, they were on the horses, they were on the camels, and the whoop fell onto the ground, they would not let anyone pick it up for them. They would get down themselves and they would get it themselves, subhanAllah. To such a level. Even though people can help you all of this here, but to such a level they would avoid asking and taking assistance from people, subhanAllah. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, he would say, Allahumma kama sunta wajhi lissujud li ghayrik. O Allah, just like how you saved my face from turning to others besides you, that you saved my face from making sajda to others besides you, fasunhu anil mas'ala li ghayrik. Then save me from asking from others. I only ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, we take a short break and then we return. Hayyakumullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hayyakumullah, ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. Your brother in Islam, Bilal Ismail. Bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, we continue our current series, 40 Ahadith of Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah. Brothers and sisters, we are currently discussing Hadith number 19. And with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, we will conclude with Hadith number 19 tonight, insha'Allah. Hadith number 19, dealing with what? Dealing with the matter of Tawheed. Brothers and sisters, we saw our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stating to Abdullah ibn Abbas, young boy, saying to him what? Saying to him, Ya ghulam, inni u'allimuka kalimat, I will teach you some words. Then the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on and says to him, Ihfazillaha yahfazk, that be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you. Ihfazillaha yahfazk. Ihfazillaha tajidhu tujahak. Be mindful of Allah. Look after the limits of Allah, the hudud of Allah, and you will find Allah before you. Then, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ. And when you ask, if you ask, ask only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, the matter of Tawheed, we find Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali rahimahullah, he states that both from the point of the Sharia, from the point of the Quran and the Sunnah, and from the angle of the Aql, the intellect, so from the Naql, which is the text, and from the Aql, the point of the rationale, one should only ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and one should not ask from anyone else. He mentions, first, a person must degrade himself in front of the one whom he is requesting something from. When you come to me and you ask something from me, when you go to Ahmed Ilyas, whoever it might be, when you go to a person, when you go to any of creation and you ask from them, technically, it means you are belittling yourself before them. You are lowering yourself before them. You are showing your faqr before them, that they are ghani, they are high, and you are the one who is low. Ibn Rajab says, to do this towards another human being, who is no more than a human being and equal to the person himself, is not becoming to anyone. It is not befitting of the individual. Imam Ahmed used to say, O Allah, in the same way that you have kept my face from prostrating to other than you, protect me from asking of anyone other than you. Hence, Ibn Rajab says, this type of requesting, an important submissiveness, because when you ask from the other, you are showing a level of your submissiveness to the other, should only be towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah alone. Thus, it becomes a form of worship and it generates love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the compassionate, the merciful. You submit yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because you know He is the one who meets the needs of the creation. That was number one. Number two, Ibn Rajab states, when asking anyone else besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to meet some need, one is showing one's dependence and one's neediness on that person to fulfill one's wants. To ask another human or any of the creation for such a thing is a kind of like wrongdoing. This is because in reality a human is powerless to bring about benefit for himself or to ward away evil from himself. Therefore, how can he be asked to do something of that nature for somebody else? He cannot even bring on benefit to himself and keep off harm from himself. So how is he going to do it to another? Then Ibn Rajab states, in that case, he is being asked to do something that he is not qualified for, and thus it is a type of wrongdoing. Furthermore, it simply does not make sense for anyone to turn to beseech, to beg before creation instead of asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is because it does not make sense for one to ignore the rich, the ghani, the most powerful, the one who is free of all need, and then to go and plea your needs to the ones who are not rich and not powerful and do not have the keys or bounties. Not only that, he mentions, there is a big difference between asking a human for something or asking creation for something and asking from Allah. In general, creation does not like to be asked for favors or bounties. Ask me one day, ask me 2 days, ask me 3 days. Boss, this is a bit too much now. Every day you ask from me, subhanAllah. That's what people would say. So when you go to creation and you ask, you know, they don't like to be asked for favors and bounties. They do not like to give up their time and their wealth for others by their nature. Ibn Rajab quotes Ibn Simak, who said that do not ask one who flees from your request. He's running or he sees you, he wants to walk in the other direction, he wants to go away from you. Do not ask the one who flees from your requests, but instead ask the one who has ordered you to ask from him, subhanAllah. How can anyone turn to creation and neglect turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, beseeching Allah for help, the one who meets all needs? How can anyone choose to ask other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If he keeps in mind what is recorded in the authentic hadith, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends. Allah descends during the last part of every night. And what does Allah ask? Is there anyone asking of me so I can grant it to him? Is there anyone supplicating to me so that I might respond to him? And also, Ibn Rajab continues, Allah is close to every human being. If the human being turns sincerely to Allah and asks from him, Allah will respond. Allah said in the Quran, who said? Allah said, Allah stated in the noble Quran, Ya akhi al-kareem wa ukhti al-kareema, wa idha sa'alaka ibadi anni, and when my slaves ask you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, about me, concerning me, Anni fa inni qareeb, then verily say, I am close to them, I am qareeb. Ujibu da'wata da'i, I answer their du'as. Look at that. Allah mentions He's close to us, and the most important matter after stating He's close to us, He says, I answer their du'as. Idha da'ani, when they make du'a to me, subhanAllah. Ya Abdallah, ya Amatallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers. So Allah asks and wants us to ask from Him, subhanAllah. Brothers and sisters, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ, when you ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember, note that when asking from others, when asking from people, when asking from others, this is of two types. Number one, that which is outside the ability of creation. It's outside of their realm. I'm asking you about what's going to happen tomorrow. Asking somebody about what's going to happen next year, etc. Asking for, my ailment to be cured, for my wife to fall pregnant, safe and security for myself, for guidance, for hidayah, that I be blessed in my job, that I have barakah in my phone, that these type of matters. Subhanallah, Allah mentions in the noble Quran, وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّا يَدْعُو مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ, and who is more in misguidance than the one who is calling on others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he will not be answered. مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ, and they will not answer him even up to يوم القيامة. Surah Ahqaf, verse number 5. But as for asking for help which is within the ability of that creation, please brother, can you help me with this box? Can you lend me your cell phone? Can you drive me somewhere? Can you lend me some money? Can you carry this? Can you look after this? Can you bring me? All these matters here, they are within the ability of that human being, within the ability of the one you are asking, then this here is fine, this here is permissible. But even in this category, if you avoid that, then that's the better route. How do we know? That hadith, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took that pledge from Abu Bakr and others that they would not ask anyone for anything. Even if the whip fell while they were on the animal, they would get down themselves, pick it up. They would not depend upon anyone for anything, subhanallah. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amat Allah, somebody asks, he says, okay, you know, but many times I make dua to Allah, but I find that my duas are not answered. Allah's not granting my dua, etc., etc. Where's the response? We say, subhanallah, brother. Allah definitely responds. What? Allah 100% responds. But remember, response is wider and bigger and greater than granting what you want. Allah responds 100%, but Allah might not grant you what you wanted. So what does that mean? Well, what's the semantics now? Allah responds but does not grant? Well, subhanAllah, sometimes Allah grants you exactly what you asked for. You wanted to get married to so-and-so, and you know that dua was answered and you got married to so-and-so. Sometimes Allah reserves for you something equally good. So something equally good you get in. Instead, sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not grant you what you wanted, but saves you and removes a harm from you. And sometimes it's just like stored for your reward in the hereafter. Either way, ad-du'a huwa al-ibadah. Du'a is the essence of worship. It's the head of worship. Your asking from Allah is ibadah. It is worship. And so you are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, granted or not granted. As that one brother, he made that du'a, and he says, oh Allah, I praise you. I praise you for not answering many of the du'as which I made in the past, which I was naive and I didn't know better. If you answered those du'as, I would have been in a worse of state. What you gave me was better than what I was asking for. Subhanallah. Sometimes we love something and it's not good for us. Sometimes we hate something and it is good for us. We don't know, and Allah is the one who knows. Brothers and sisters, also note that du'a is a means to fulfilling a need. You have a need, well, du'a is a means to fulfilling that need. But sometimes there might be obstacles. You're indulging in haram, you're oppressing somebody. So although you are making the dua and all of this here all in order, but there are obstacles. The duas work when the duas are proper and there are no obstacles. Just like somebody using a sword. You give it to a kid, he's unable to use the sword. You need somebody who is well versed in the usage of the sword, somebody who's strong, somebody who can lift it, somebody who is using the sword which is also sharp. And thus the dua is like that sword. It needs to be done properly. It needs to be sharp. The one making the dua also has to be right. The one holding that sword has to be right. So that's with regards to dua. What about begging from people? The only time you can beg from people, I mean, subhanAllah, we saw many of the sahaba would not even ask somebody for a favor. How much with regards to the matter of begging? Allah musta'an. Our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at what a level he goes to when it comes to trying to encourage the mu'min, the believer, the one who has honor, izzah, dignity, that don't depend upon the people. Don't ask and beg from the people. He says that, لَإِنَّ يَحْتَزِمْ أَحَدُكُمْ, that if any one of you has to go and get some hatab, فَيَحْمِلُهَا عَلَى ظَهْرِهِ فَيَبِيعَهَا خَيْرٌ لَهُ مِنْ أَذْ يَسْأَلْ رَجُلًا يُعْطِيهِ أَوْ يَمْنَعُهُ. That if any one of you went out and he collected some wood, put it on his back, carried it on his back, then he sold those pieces of wood, firewood, and he sold it and he made some money, this is better for him than him asking a person. Maybe this person gives him, maybe the person does not give him. And you lose your face, subhanAllah. When you ask from others, you lose your face. Allah musta'an. That's why the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, this person who continuously begs comes on Yawm al-Qiyamah and he's got no flesh on his face. Allah musta'an. The poet, he says, لا تقصد المخلوق ربك أقرب. Do not seek out the creation, your Rabb is closer to you. وَمَنْ قَصَدَ الْمَخْلُوقَ لَا شَكَّ يَتْعَبْ. Whoever seeks out creation, definitely he will get tired. You will get tired, and they also will get tired by your asking. لَا يَسْأَلَنَّ بُنَيَّ آدَمْ حَاجَةً. Don't ask the children of Adam for your need. وَسَلِ الَّذِي أَبْوَابَهُ أَبْوَابُهُ لَا يُحْجَبْ. Ask the one whose doors you know, are open, they are never closed, there's no guards there. Allahu yaghdabu in tarakta su'alahu. Allah gets angry when you don't ask from him. Wa bunayya Adam hina yus'alu yaghdabu. And the children of Adam, when you ask from them, what happens? When you ask from them, they get angry. Allahu musta'an. Allah gets angry when you do not ask, and the children of Adam, they get angry when you do ask from them. Allahu musta'an. Ya Abdullah, ya Amat Allah. Then the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam states, وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. And when you seek help, seek assistance, seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are all in need. We need assistance. We need help. So when we seek help, seek it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because this is like an admission that you are weak. You're a weakling, you're a weak creature, it humbles you. What do we say? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. That there is no might, there is no, Allah mustan, there is no might, there is no power, no might, no power, except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. La hawl wa la quwwa illa billah, except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you seek help, seek that assistance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In our salah, minimum 17 times a day we say, Iyaka na'budu, only you do we worship. وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, and only from you do we seek assistance. Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Surah Anbiya, verse number 12, what did he mention there? وَقَالَ رَبِّحْكُمْ بِالْحَقِّ وَرَبُّنَا الرَّحْمَنُ الْمُسْتَعَانُ عَلَى مَا تَصِفُونَ. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is making isti'ana upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yaqub alayhi salam, when they said to him that your son Yusuf has been killed, etc., etc., what did he say? فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانُ وَاللَّهُ مُسْتَعَانُ عَلَى مَا تَصِفُونَ. And I seek assistance in Allah with regards to what you people have said. I seek assistance and help in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, we said, لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. This is a treasure from the treasures of Jannah. Hadith reported by Imam al-Bukhari. And إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Ibn Rajab said that the key aspect of all of the revealed books returns to and revolves around this one sentence. What did you say, Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali? He said that the summary of all the books revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Torah, the Injil, every type of revelation, the Quran, all of them put together, the key aspect of all of the revealed books, they return to and they revolve around إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Only you do we worship, the matter of Tawheed, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. And thus, we only seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives a beautiful example. وَعْلَمْ, and know. وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْأُمَّةَ, and know that if the ummah, if the nation, if everyone got together. وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْأُمَّةَ لَوْ اجْتَمَعَتْ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَنْفَعُوكَ بِشَيْءٍ لَمْ يَنْفَعُوكَ إِلَّا بِشَيْءٍ قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ لَكَ. And know that if the nations got together and they wanted to benefit you somehow, they will not be able to benefit you except if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written that for you. وَإِنْ اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَضُرُّوكَ بِشَيْءٍ. If they all got together, the nations, they everyone got together and they wanted to harm you, they will not be able to harm you except if Allah had written that harm for you. رُفِعَتِ الْأَقْلَامُ وَجَفَّتِ الصُّحُفُ. The pens have been lifted and the pages have dried. Brothers and sisters, subhanAllah. The statement, if they all got together to help you or to harm you, this is like an explanation of what has already come before. That all of the universe cannot help, they cannot harm you. They cannot bring you any benefit. They do not have the power. SubhanAllah. You know, the iman in this, the belief of the Muslim who truly believes in this, subhanAllah, super powerful, super powerful. This builds courage. All power is with Allah. And that we are then in awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there's no reason to fear others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your life, your success, your provision, your boss, none of them can do anything. None of them can put it forward, they cannot put it back. Your risk is meant for you, it will come to you, subhanAllah. A brother, he mentions that Sheikh Ali Tantawi, he mentions that there was this Afghani foreign minister, one of the ministers in the old Afghanistan government. before the invasion of the Soviets. He had some business, he needed to go to Russia for some meeting, and thus he was sent, landed there. But before going, he said to the wife, you know, we're traveling there, and you know, halal food issue, problem, etc. So what you do is, you know, maybe take, this is now in the 60s and the 70s, you know, take some of this chicken along, and while we're there, you know, you can prepare it, and at least we'll have our own food. And so the wife went along with him, and his minister, he took this and went. When he was there in Russia, the meeting, etc., was cancelled, and he had a dinner invite that evening with the Mufti. And so he comes to the hotel and he says to the wife, you know what, we've been invited, and so there's no need for that meal now. I've already prepared it, subhanAllah. He says, anyway, now, you know what, we've got this dinner invite. So they didn't eat the food and they went for the dinner invite. The next morning, before that meeting that he traveled all the way for, he receives some communication. You know what, the meeting's cancelled. There's no need for it now. You need to immediately come back to Kabul. And so they took the next flight out. But before leaving, they said, this chicken now that we already prepared, you know, what should we do with it? So they, you know, went onto the street there and they looked, they found this one woman. The signs of like hunger were on her face, and she had these three kids with her. And so they gave that chicken, was nice, prepared, roast or whatever, and they gave it to that entire family, and they ate, walhamdulillah, and thus that minister came back. So Sheikh Ali Tantawi mentions this qissa, and he says, subhanallah, look at this, look at the wisdom of Allah, look at the qudra of Allah. It is as if, and it is subhanallah, that this woman, she was hungry in this Russian village town. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had written her rizq that it would come from this chicken prepared by the minister's wife from Afghanistan. So it's as if, because the meeting never happened, it is as if this man took a flight from Kabul, came all the way to Russia just to give that woman this chicken and go back. Bottom line, that's like exactly what happened, subhanAllah. Because meeting was cancelled, the government issue all was gone over. So the only thing that came out of it was what? They traveled all the way, prepared that meal, and gave to that woman who had three kids, subhanAllah. What's meant for you will never miss you, brothers. Whatever was not meant for you will never come to you, O sisters. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. This correct belief builds within the Muslim contentment, peace, tranquility of the heart. Allah states in the noble Quran, وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِضُرٍ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ بِخَيْرٍ فَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. If Allah touches you with harm, none can remove it. وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ بِخَيْرٍ. And if Allah touches you with goodness, فَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Allah is over all matters powerful. The believer believes in this, it grants him strength, grants him courage, subhanAllah. It grants that believer that courage. He walks onto the battlefield and he walks in the face of the enemy. It gives courage to that Palestinian little boy, subhanAllah, in the face of that infantry and the army and the tanks. He picks up those stones and he's not afraid, subhanAllah. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. Everything is in the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thus it is wise that one submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The entire universe can't harm you, cannot benefit you. Thus submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rufi'at al-aqlam, the pens have been lifted and the books are dry. This is in relation to the qada and the qadr, the preordainment. We find the verse in the noble Quran, ما أصاب من مصيبة في الأرض ولا في أنفسكم إلا في كتاب من قبل أن نبرأها إن ذلك على الله يسير. No calamity befalls on the earth or in yourselves except that it has been inscribed in the book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the pen and then said to it, write whatever is to come. Whatever is to come. So whatever occurs, all of this has already been recorded. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even before recording, obviously has knowledge with regards to all of that. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. That was the end of that portion of the hadith. Then the other narration states that, the other narration mentions, احفظ الله تجده أمامك. Be mindful of Allah and you will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before you. Ta'arraf ila Allahi fi ar-rakha. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. That Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that be mindful of Allah. Get to know Allah. Remember Allah during your good times. And then Allah will know you during your times of adversity. Become beloved to Allah during the times of prosperity. Your good times, mashallah. Become beloved to Allah during that time. And Allah will know you during your times of adversity. When you need Allah, then Allah would know you. So find solace in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, Man sarrahu an yastajiba Allahu lahu inda shada'id. Whoever wants Allah to answer his calls, his du'as during the difficult times, Jayid, so what should he do? فَلْيُكْثِرْ الدُّعَى فِي الرَّخَى. Then let him increase his dua during the good times. Subhanallah. Everyone turns to Allah during the tough times. Everyone becomes a dhakir of Allah during the tough times. When things are, you know, when they're in anxiety, when there's worry, when things are in danger, everybody remembers Allah. But during the good times, subhanallah. Find solace in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the good times. Then Allah will assist you during the tough times. Look at Yunus alayhi salam. Allah states in the noble Quran, فَلَوْلَا أَنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ لَلَبِيثَ فِي بَطْنِهِ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبَعَثُونَ. If it was not for the fact that Yunus alayhi salam, he used to make a lot of tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Had it not been for that, then he would have remained in the belly of that fish until Yawm al-Qiyamah. So what benefited him? The fact that he would remember Allah during the good times. Somebody asked Abu Darda for advice, and he said that remember Allah in your good times, Allah will remember you during your hard times. And look at the opposite. Look at, for example, Fir'aun and others. Allah musta'an. Fir'aun, when he wanted to, at the time of drowning, make tawbah, Allah states, Al-ana waqad asayta qablu wa kunta minal mufsidin. Now you want to make tawbah? Before all of this time you were living in zulm and oppression and you were, you know, oppressing, you were a zalim. Now you want to make tawbah? No. Allah musta'an. Nasullaha fa ansahum anfusahum ulaika humul fasiqun. They forgot Allah and thus they were forgotten. And remember, then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, wa'alam anna ma akhta'aka lam yakun liyusibak. And know that whatever was not meant for you, whatever ma akhta'aka lam yakun liyusibak, that whatever missed you, whatever did not come to you, that deal, that person, this, whatever it might be, was not meant for you. Lam yakun liyusibak, it would have never ever come to you. It wasn't meant for you, subhanallah. Wama asabaka lam yakun liyukhti'ak, and whatever was supposed to come to you, whatever came to you, whatever was meant for you, was never ever going to miss you, subhanallah. Then the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ النَّصْرَ مَعَ الصَّبْرِ. And know that victory comes with patience. Victory comes with patience, with perseverance. Perseverance, عَلَى طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ. You have sabr. Waking up for Salatul Fajr is not easy. Fasting in Ramadan is not easy. Praying five times a day is not easy, subhanAllah. But you persevere with all of that. Lowering your gaze is a jihad at times, and you persevere with that. Staying away from riba and zina is a major jihad, and you stay away. You are making sabr upon the obedience of Allah. And sabr anil ma'asiyah, you observe sabr and you stay away from that haram. It's not only in public that you stay away from the haram, but more especially in private, you stay away from that haram. Allah musta'an. And remember, brothers and sisters, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions, وَأَنَّ الْفَرَجَ مَعَ الْكَرْبِ. And victory comes with patience and relief with affliction. إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. وَأَنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. After difficult times comes ease, subhanallah. Look at Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, living in Mecca, he was beaten. He had to leave Mecca al-Mukarramah, comes to Medina al-Munawwara. There was a sense of relief there, walhamdulillah. 8th year after the Hijrah, he is the conqueror of Mecca al-Mukarramah. Subhanallah. There were times when the Sahaba, they had nothing to eat. They were eating, you know, leaves of the trees. And fast forward 20, 30 years, the Persian Empire and the Roman Empire are at their feet. SubhanAllah, times turn. The difficult times will never ever remain forever. As the ulama state that with one difficulty, there are two eases. Inna ma'al usri yusra. Based upon the ending of that surah, that al-usr, but there's two yusr. Al-usr is mentioned al-usr, and then al-usr has the alif and lam of ta'rif, and thus it's the same usr, but it has two separate independent eases, and thus similar to the narration, lan yaghliba usrun yusrain, that one difficulty will not overpower two eases. Every difficulty then comes with ease. Look at Yusuf alayhi salam, from the well, subhanallah, unto where? Then he was in charge. Yaqub alayhi salam thought that his son was killed, etc. Other sons plotting and planning, and eventually lost his eyesight. Eyesight came back. Yunus alayhi salam in the belly of the well, belly of the whale, and eventually he was saved, subhanallah. In fact, that belly of the whale was protection for him. Musa alayhi salam, throw him into that river. Where does he go? Why, Fir'aun and his men want to slaughter the kids. Eventually, where does he end up? The palace of Fir'aun. Brought up where? Brought up in the palace of Fir'aun, subhanallah. Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, read surah, Alam nashrah laka sadrak, wa wada'na anka wizrak, alladhi anqada zahrak, wa rafa'na laka dhikrak, fa inna ma'al usri yusra, inna ma'al usri yusra, subhanallah. Repetition of that after difficulty definitely comes ease. In our contemporary situation, Nelson Mandela, 27 years in jail, and then ease comes after that. You are sick, you are ill, ease comes after that. Even if one passes away during that illness, due to that illness. Illness was only the excuse. All of that was wiping away of your sins. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah. When one is in a state of hardship, one has tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And remember, one gets closer to Allah during this time. One makes a lot of dua. أَمَّا يُجِيبُ الْمُطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءُ. Who is the one who removes this calamity and these trials and tribulations from insan? None other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the scholars have written at great length with regards to the benefits of difficulties, benefits of trials and tribulations. If it was not for the tough times, we would not value the good times, subhanallah. Ya Abdullah, Ya Amatullah, it seems that time is against us. Walhamdulillah, bi-iznillahi ta'ala, we've concluded the most important matters pertaining to hadith number 19. The matter of tawheed, the matter of hardship and ease coming after it, the matter of whatever is meant for you will not miss you, whatever is not meant for you will never come to you. Nobody can harm you, nobody can benefit you had it not been written for you, subhanallah. Builds up the courage, the tawfiq, the tawheed, the tawakkul, the reliance, the dependence upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Muslim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us khair and barakah. May Allah reward us. May Allah record our sitting in our scales of good deeds. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالُ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us knowledge which is beneficial, knowledge that we don't just learn from, but rather knowledge that we implement in our lives, that we remember, that we remind others, that we take benefit, khair and barakah from it. May Allah resurrect us in the company of Imam al-Nawawi, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the rest of the Sahaba. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.